Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. There are no apologies received this morning. So our first item of business is a decision to take agenda item 3 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session with the Fair Work Convention. The purpose of today's meeting is to provide members with an introduction to the work of the Fair Work Convention and to discuss with them the challenges and opportunities facing businesses and workers. I welcome Mary Alexander and Patricia Finlay, who are co-chairs of the Fair Work Convention, and are joined by Helen Martin, who's head of the Fair Work Convention Secretariat. As always, can I ask members and witnesses to keep their questions and answers short and concise as possible, and I invite Mary Alexander to make a short opening statement.
Thank you. The Fair Work Convention brings together employers and unions from across the public, private and third sectors and is supported by academic expertise. We operate in the tradition of social dialogue and therefore have a balanced representation of both employers and trade unions. The Convention is a relatively small organisation with 11 members. We receive funding from government and we are supported by a small multidisciplinary secretariat which is based within the Scottish Government. But we are independent of government and our remit is twofold. One is to advise Scottish ministers on fair work and the other is to advocate and promote fair work. Our vision, shared with the Scottish Government, is that Scotland will be a leading fair work nation by 2025. To this end, the Convention has played a leading role in defining fair work through the Fair Work Framework, which was published in 2016. We have drawn on international learning and considered the available evidence in Scotland and across the UK on what works and defined fair work using five dimensions. These are security, opportunity, fulfilment, respect and effective voice. We also looked at Scotland's progress on fair work and we developed the Fair Work Measurement Framework, which was first published in December 2020. We also hope to publish a refresh of this measurement framework in spring next year. In order to deliver our remit effectively and to have the greatest impact within our current resources, we've developed a work plan that focuses on two main activities. The first is we seek to build capacity and understanding of fair work across key organisations. This area of work is about supporting organisations who play a key economic development or scrutiny role to build fair work effectively into the work that they do. So we have a key focus on organisations like the Scottish Government, the enterprise agencies and Audit Scotland. We also work with employer bodies, unions and organisations like the CIPD to help build a wider capacity and understanding of what fair work means and how they can deliver it in their own organisations. Secondly, we use our in-depth inquiry function to look at specific sectors of the economy. We choose sectors where we consider there to be specific fair work challenges. We then bring together employers, employer bodies, unions, workers, and relevant public bodies and run a series of thematic meetings looking at the experience of fair work by the workforce and the barriers that exist in the sector to improving fair work outcomes. We then work with the stakeholders to agree recommendations that will support progress on fair work. By taking this approach, we're able to look at complex issues that may require a range of interventions from a range of actors. We also use our convening function to raise awareness of fair work issues in the sectors concerned and to support all actors to understand the need for change, as well as the specific steps that can then be taken to achieve this. The Convention has to date completed two sectoral inquiries. The first was into social care, and we published our inquiry report in 2019. The second was into construction, and reported in April 2022. We've now launched our third inquiry into hospitality in June this year. The inquiry had its third meeting yesterday and is due to report in spring 2024. Our inquiries are long and in-depth, but are widely acknowledged to provide valuable, concrete and achievable progress on complex fair work issues that are a consequence of how business models function within sectors. To finish, I'd like to thank the committee for the invite here today to discuss the work of the Convention and Fair Work in Scotland. We hope to be able to support the work of the committee going forward, and we hope that the evidence we provide today will be of value and will help inform your future work. Thanks.
Thank you. Could I begin by maybe asking some questions about progress on fair work? So in December 2020, you referred to the report card that was published, where the Convention raised concerns about lack of progress on realising the 2025 vision. And then in March 21, the Convention warned unless the Scottish Government took urgent action, the vision wouldn't be realised. So have you seen the urgent action that you were calling for? Are there areas and actions you think the Government need to take forward to make sure that we can reach the 2025 target? And why has progress in some areas been so slow?
I'll defer to my colleague, my other co-chair, to respond to that. Thanks.
Thank you. Welcome, Patricia. Would you like to respond to the first questions?
Yes, I would do. Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation today. Apologies for not being able to be with you. A work commitment requires me to be in Glasgow very soon after the committee stops hearing. So part of the answer to your question is that fair work's quite difficult. It's multidimensional. There are no particularly easy sets of measures, although there are good subcomponent measures of fair work. So if we were to look at something like payment of the real living wage, we would say that there has been quite significant progress in Scotland in trying to improve the number of people who have access to the real living wage. When we look at some other areas that we measure, for example, some of the recommendations we've made in inquiries, or indeed some of the measures of things like what constitutes fulfilling work, or who has access to good effective voice mechanisms at work, it's much more difficult to measure those things, and we don't see the same level of progress. So in the instances that you've talked about, we've encouraged an urgency to try and address some of the areas where we think some gains can be made. We appreciate that that's difficult. We appreciate that external circumstances have, in the last few years, made that somewhat more difficult and continue to do so. But it's not simply the case that difficult external circumstances can be seen as an obstacle to fair work. We have to think about how we use those circumstances in ways in which we can leverage fair work better. So, for example, just to give one example that might be helpful, if you look at how much effective voice there is across Scottish workplaces, we see some quite distinctive patterns. We see a relatively well unionised public sector, and we see a much more lowly unionised private sector. It's not impossible that there are voice mechanisms that exist within private sector organisations, but it is generally accepted across the globe that independent trade union representation is the gold standard of effective voice. We saw developments in that during the pandemic. We saw opportunities in terms of responding to the public health emergency and developing things like guidance on working safely. We saw a development of good, effective voice mechanisms. So we did see some progress, even in quite difficult times. And difficulty can act as a catalyst towards improving some of the mechanisms of fair work that we're really interested in looking at. So there's no single measure. There are a variety of different measures. They don't always move in tandem. So we might see improvements in some, but not in others. So we've seen, for example, a rise in the number of people who can access the real living wage, who are paid the real living wage. But what we've also seen alongside that, along with the rest of the UK, is significantly declining real wages. So trying to push all of the levers of fair work on at the same time is challenging. We understand that. We understand the difficulties that government face. We understand the difficulties that businesses face. But we believe very strongly that that central objective, which is to be a leading fair work nation, to allow fair work to drive benefit for the people in our labour force, for their families, for their communities, for our wider economy and for society, we still believe that's a really important objective. And the members of the convention, who Mary introduced, all of whom work and deliver their expertise and their experience and their strong relationships across the Fair Work ecosystem, pro bono, as it were. Nobody in the convention is paid. The budget that we have funds our secretariat and a small research budget. But all of those people do that because they are fundamentally committed to the objective of being a leading Fair Work nation in Scotland and to putting in place measures that will show us that even though it's difficult, we are making some progress. We have at the moment a plan to have some a measurement framework developed that will benchmark Scotland against relevant other countries in terms of their Fair Work performance, and that will be completed and launched sometime in 2023. So following the 2019 report, following our comments in 2021, we've urged not just government but other stakeholders, because government's not the only player here, but government is an important player. We've urged those stakeholders to try and push forward the cause of Fair Work, and we hope that we'll be able to pick up some of that in our measurement framework in 2023.
Thank you. You've started to address some of the issues other members will want to pick up on, but can I just return? The 2020 report from December did say that the COVID-19 crisis had laid bare much of the unfairness in our economy, and that even before the pandemic, limited progress is being made in delivering on key Fair Work indicators. The refreshed plan is due out, I think, quite soon. I think it was meant to be autumn, so it's due quite soon. What do you see? Do you think the refreshed plan will be able to address some of the existing unfairness that was there and that has been added to by the pandemic? Will that be the focus of the plan, or what is likely to be in terms of addressing gaps? Where is the plan going to be focused on?
Well, so the Fair Work Action Plan is the job of the Scottish Government. It's not the job of the Convention. So while we have discussions,
so what would you like to see in that plan when it comes forward?
Can I preface that with an answer to the earlier part of your question? We know that fair work practices and the absence of fair work practices are really quite sticky in the Scottish economy and elsewhere. So we know that there are people who tend to get, if they have one element one element where they don't meet fair work, they tend to have other elements. So if you are low paid, you're much less likely to have a secure contract. If you're low paid and don't have a secure contract, you're much less likely to have access to training and development or access to career progression. So there's a configuration, there's a bunching effect of fair work dimensions that benefit some workers and don't benefit others. We know that the pandemic exacerbated some of those difficulties. So we know that the people who were worse off in the economy continued to be worse off. We also know, if we're speaking much more positively, that the people, the businesses and organisations who'd invested in good fair work practices found those to be a significant benefit during the pandemic. They allowed them to be agile and flexible, to keep their workforce on board while they did things in a very different context. So we know that there's some intractable challenges of fair work, and we would like to see the action plan focus on those areas which are really quite intractable. So specifically the issue of low pay. Low pay is really, really challenging for fair work. It's very difficult if you have low pay to pick up on other elements of good and fair work. And we would like to see that addressed in the sectors where low pay is endemic. We'd like to see an emphasis on how government engage with the employer community to be able to say, to discuss the kinds of business models and approaches which produce fair work on the one hand and work that's less fair on the other hand. So some of the work that's been done by SCDI around business purpose has been helpful in that, in trying to open up a discussion with the employer community about how they can respond to the demands of fair work by adopting a more stakeholder-oriented business purpose. We would like to see much more emphasis around those parts of the labour force that don't have access to sick pay and how we might support some of that development. Addressing some of the issues around sort of insecurity in work, we think there's a really important example and role modelling for the Scottish Government and the public sector to take around broader voice in industrial relations. We know that it's a difficult time for industrial relations, so we know that there are a number of, and Mary will be able to talk to this in her role as a union officer, there's a much higher rate of industrial action now. We know that that's fueled by the cost of living crisis, amongst other things. But we would like to see some creative work around how we get voice and dialogue in Scotland that's effective, and that might be at a sectoral level or it might be at an organisational level.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Graham Simpson, who will be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks. Thanks very much, convener. Patricia, if you're answering, could you keep your answers a bit shorter, if that's okay? But I will turn to whoever wants to answer this. So I've been looking at the website, and in my own head, I wanted to have a definition of what we mean by fair work, because clearly that could mean different things to different people. And you have a definition which is 76 pages long on your website, so that's quite a lot. So how on earth are employers meant to take all that in? And my second question is, despite what Patricia has just said, can you tell me what the Fair Work Convention has actually achieved so far? Any actual tangible outcomes? So I don't know who wants to answer that. Mary, do you want to try that, or Helen?
Yeah. If I can come in and then, Helen can add to it. I mean, you've referred to, the lengthy detail around the Fair Work Framework, which there is a shorter version, a much shorter version, and I think the actual principles, say it all, actually. So security, effective voice, opportunity, fulfilment, they're quite obvious about, what it is that they mean. I'm sure I don't need to go into detail around that. But those were, we came up with those five principles after really extensive research, international research about what a fair work place looks like. What does it mean, to workers? So as a trade union official, they chime with me, particularly the security and effective voice aspects of them, because effective voice is really important. To your point about, what have we achieved, I would point to the sectoral inquiries that we've done. So we have done one, as we've said, on social care, which the recommendations were published in 2019. And, the benefit of those was that we sat round with all stakeholders and done an 18-month inquiry, really looking at, what are the issues here facing social care workers, who are largely 84% women. What are the challenges in that sector? What are the challenges that employers see there? And we really went into great detail around that and came up with five recommendations. Now, the frustration with that is that what came from that was three working groups that looked at those recommendations and how to take those forwards. And they're still going. However, there's been quite a lot of work done, for example, on terms and conditions in those work streams and what effective voice looks like. So, we're very positive about those recommendations and about those being taken forward as the Feely Review recommended that they should be taken forward sort of lock, stock and barrel. And we continue to meet with government officials on that and influence that, because, as you know, social care is a very hot topic, and we remain, there is a crisis in recruitment and retention.
I've
I'll jump in there because you're right. You have produced reports. Yeah, we'll come to you, Helen. And you produce a recent one on the construction industry, which I've just flicked through. I mean, it's very interesting. It raises the issues that many of us have heard many times before. My concern is, it's all fascinating stuff, but what comes as a result of it? You know, you've sat down with people in the construction industry. You've produced a report. How are we going to monitor change? Will that report lead to anything? And are you going to be the driver of change? Because if you're not, then what's the point of it all?
Well, I mean, sorry, I'll let Helen come in a minute, but, the construction report, again, we sat around with all the stakeholders and really looked at what the challenges are in construction, what is the work experience in there, what can we do to change that? And we have met with Ivan McKee and set out our recommendations, and we're currently waiting on a response to those. And our job is to advise the Scottish Government, and we've done that on the social care report and the construction report. And we'll continue to push for those recommendations, which were the outcome of a collaboration with the other bodies involved. Helen, if you...
Yeah, just on a couple of general points. So on the specific point on construction, I think we do recognise the need to continue to push the government to try to adopt the recommendations and others in the sector. And we've actually recommended in the report a recommendation for ourselves to actually come back and formally review the piece of work in 5 years as a way of trying to signal the degree to which we're serious about coming back and seeing the progress that is made in this sector. So I think we do recognise the need to sort of continue to drive that progress. On some of the specific things on support for employers, I think as well we do recognise that the Fair Work Framework is quite a weighty document. It sets out all the evidence around Fair Work, but that isn't our main sort of communication with employers. I mean, we've had a 2-minute YouTube video, which I think sums it up quite well and that I would tend to use when I go to speak to employers. We also have a self-assessment tool for employers that's housed with Scottish Enterprise that allows employers to do to sit down, answer a few questions, and then they get a sort of sense of where they are in terms of Fair Work and an action plan coming out of that about how they can improve their business. We equally have one for the workforce that they can sort of do a sort of survey for their own workplace and understand how their experience of Fair Work compares against other people, and gives them a sense of what they might be able to ask for in their own workplace or how to work together with other employees to make change. So we do quite a bit of thinking about how we communicate this out to other stakeholders. And just lastly, we've also developed a microsite, a free-to-use microsite with CIPD Scotland, which sets out specific information by each Fair Work dimension for employers to use so that they can sort of put specific policies into their workplace that align with the Fair Work Framework. So we're continuing to kind of work with partners to try to drive forward understanding and operationalise Fair Work in the workplace. But it is, a fairly slow and complicated process. But what I would say is employers understand this stuff. It's not a million miles away from what they already do. But I think what it does, it provides them a really good framework for breaking down the experience of work in their workplace and driving it forward.
Yeah, so it's a collaborative thing, it seems to me. And there's probably a role for this committee to work. I mean, you're here today, but we can work closely in monitoring this stuff. I've just got one final question, because I know others want in. You mentioned at the start, I think it was you, Mary, mentioned it, that you receive some government funding. How much is that?
Helen,
it's £500,000 a year. So that pays for all the staffing and also the programme budget.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm going to change order and bring in Jamie Harcourt-Johnson, as I think his question is relevant to what we've heard so far, and then I'll come to Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. If I can direct my questions to you, Mary, and if you could perhaps direct them as you see fit. You talked there about the CARE report, which came out in 2000, social care sector report that came out in 2019, and you said it's now at it's the stage of three working groups. I don't know when those are going to deliver their results, but that'll be kind of probably roughly 4 years at least before they deliver their findings. So, you know, respect that it's not a quick process. The questions I was going to ask was around about the essentially the outcomes, but we're not there yet. So what I will do is I maybe have a look at the some of the challenges the sector continues to face. And also, there have been issues raised by trade unions and workers around the new National Care Service. I'm just wondering if there are any issues or concerns that you have around that and its impact on Fair Work.
Actually, I was here yesterday, you know, as a witness from the trade union point of view. So in terms of Fair Work and the social care inquiry, you know, our focus has really been on those recommendations that are in there to be taken forward as part of the National Care Service, and that is, you know, taking a sectoral approach. We have had three working groups, which I alluded to, and since the social care report, one of the problems is the sort of chronic, the very low wages in that sector, and since the report came out, there has been increases so that the social care staff are now on the real living wage, and that's been a very welcome development, particularly in you know, the private sector, where there wasn't that baseline, and there was very varying rates and 0 hour contracts. So there has been progress with the working groups, and they're now looking at terms and conditions in there and how to create sectoral bargaining, particularly in that sector. I'm trying to think what else you had said there.
It was really just around, as I say, you know, impact of, say, the National Care, the plans around the National Care Service on Fair Work. Do you see an impact there? Do you think it's deliverable? Will it see improvements, or could it be a distraction? You know, what are your general thoughts?
Well, I think that in terms of Fair Work, that, you know, we need to have the social care inquiry recommendations enacted in the National Care Service so that everybody's on a level playing field. There's a job evaluation system in place. There's, you know, a clear career progression for workers there. And, you know, the National Care Service does provide that opportunity. There are a lot of, you know, other issues with it. I would say, you know, for example, with the proposal to create care boards and transfer staff from local authorities, because that creates a lot of insecurity for staff. And if they're too paid across, for example, to the care boards, and they then may be too paid somewhere else, there's, you know, a great deal of uncertainty there from local authority staff about what will happen to them. So there's issues around that are concerning, and you know, that we've talked about.
What would you think your role will be as an organisation, ensuring that some of those concerns that you have, both as the convention, but also as a trade union official and other kind of areas of responsibility that some of your members will have? How do you ensure, and what are the kind of avenues for ensuring that those are included?
Well, you know, it's like everything. It's about communication and you know, being in the stakeholder groups and participating in discussions around it. I know that we've certainly had a number of discussions around that social care inquiry recommendations and you know, trying to take those forward as part of the National Care Service.
Okay. I suppose, lastly, because I know there's a lot of questions, I mean, do you have confidence that the National Care Service, as proposed or maybe as might be delivered, will improve outcomes?
I think that there's obviously it's a framework bill the way it is at the moment, and you know, with my trade union hat on, I have a different view from, you know, the Fair Work Convention hat on. So I think, you know, there's got to be a lot more dialogue around it and a lot more understanding about the impacts and working through some of the challenges that are there. Because at the moment, there's a lot of unclear outcomes, and that's never good for anyone.
Okay, thanks.
Colin Smith to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I go back to your December 2020 report? You made five quite specific recommendations around improvements in sectors where performance was poor, such as agriculture and fishing, improvements for disabled workers, ethnic minorities, women, conditionality and grants, access to training and collective bargaining. Patricia touched on some of the progress that's been made, and it's primarily around the living wage, for example. And obviously the government have now made a commitment to link grants to the living wage, but that's an area where we've already seen progress. What I'm keen to know is, in those areas where you haven't seen progress yet, what are the specific policy levers you think the Scottish Government should use in order to deliver that progress? I don't know who wants to start on that. Well, I think Patricia's trying to come in, so we'll maybe kick off with Patricia.
Thank you. I think the issue, so conditionality in grants, which is something that the Convention argued very strongly for in its initial report and has been taken up by the Scottish Government. So in terms of what impact the Convention has, we've pushed very heavily for conditionality. And the Fair Work First conditionality around grants and procurement isn't simply in relation to the real living wage. It's broader than the real living wage. So it asks for actions in a number of key Fair Work areas. So we think that that's quite an important area and an important lever for government to try and effect change so that public funding is used to drive and improve Fair Work. And that would be in things like making sure you have effective voice and ensuring that when you give contracts and grants to organisations in Scotland, that they have given evidence in their bids that they have effective voice. So that's a really important lever of conditionality. But government has other roles. It has roles in its relationship with the employer community. It has roles to encourage and support and facilitate dialogue. And those are all important ways in which government can help, as we try and do with the inquiries, convene and facilitate people so that you can create solutions that work in context, because Fair Work doesn't look the same everywhere.
If anybody else wants to come in the back of that.
Thanks, Colin. I think there's been some very interesting progress in terms of we talked a lot in our report about the need to create sector level Fair Work processes, I think we called it. And what we kind of meant by that was trying to build on some of the progress that had happened in the pandemic, where employers and unions and the government had worked really closely together to develop the Safer Workplaces guidance, have worked closely together to sort of respond to the pandemic. And we thought that that was a very useful kind of way of working. And we'd sort of spoken to government quite a lot about continuing that way of working, that approach to tackling issues after the pandemic. And we have seen now some improvement within the role of industry leadership groups. So you're more likely now to see trade union seats on industry leadership groups than you would have been in the past. The Construction Industry Forum, Leadership Forum, for example, is a really very inclusive organisation that brought together lots of different types of employers. And that's sort of a big change in how that sector's working, and I think much improved. We've also now seen the creation of industry leadership groups in retail and in hospitality, which is really, really important. And I think the industry leadership group in retail is actually committed to producing a Fair Work agreement as set out in NSET. And I think that, you know, that we look to that as actually good progress in terms of building the building blocks that you need to start to make the sorts of changes that you want to see in sectors. So, you know, there are sectors that we would like to see more progress in, and they were set out in our report. So we'd like to see some, you know, focus on agriculture and other sectors where there are issues. But it is good to see some progress in this space in terms of what's happening in retail with the Fair Work agreements. It's the beginning of a process, though. So I think there's still quite a long way to go before that has, you know, tangible impacts on sort of Fair Work outcomes that are measurable at an economy level.
don't know if Mary, is there anything you want to add, Mary? Or, I mean, can I come back on that point? Obviously, there's progress around those groups, but on the point earlier about conditionality, I mean, what specifically are we saying on conditionality? You know, at the moment, we're moving to a position whereby the living wage will have to be paid for government grants, long overdue. I remember proposing it as a councillor 15 years ago and being told it was illegal, so we're getting there eventually. But, I mean, we saw a whole host of grants being handed out during COVID where there was no conditionality at all. And there were businesses taking grants to get through the week, but still making people redundant, still handing out zero-hour contracts. You know, so what specifics should we be attaching to that conditionality that goes beyond the living wage? Should we be saying, effectively, you have to have collective bargaining or move towards that? Should we be saying that you have no zero-hour contracts? Because, well, we have a lot of levers here in Scotland that we can use that when it comes to linking grants. So where do we really think we should be pushing that particular lever?
Do you want me to answer? Well, I think in terms of, you know, there's lots of things we'd like to see around conditionality, and particularly, you know, we say effective voice, you know, unions are the effective voice of the workforce, and when we drew up the principles and we looked, and it was about, you know, what makes a productive workplace. The research that we done showed, of course, that, you know, having that union voice there was really fun.
That should be linked to a grant, you know, effectively. You hand out a big grant to a company that employs 300-400 people. We should be saying, actually, you need collective bargaining in that workplace in return for that grant, is that?
I think, what we should be saying is, how do you evidence effective voice? And that's what's missing. You know, people can, you know, for example, in procurement, you know, they can say they're a fair work employer and you know, offer some evidence, but we don't really scrutinise the evidence. And yes, you know, that for us, you know, the trade union voice is the, you know, gold standard of effective voice, and that's what we'd want. But it's the lack of scrutiny around, you know, effective voice. It's the lack of monitoring when people have grants or you know, they're in for a procurement bid. Then we would want them to be able, unions to be able to access the workplace and have collective bargaining there as part of it. But we'd also want monitoring in place as well to demonstrate that, you know, whoever's the successful bidder is doing what they say they're doing, and in terms of a fair workplace.
Okay. Just finally, is there any other? I mean, so we looked at conditionality around contracts. Is there any other, I suppose, policy levers at our disposal as a Parliament, as a Scottish Government, that we should be using, specific policy changes, you think, we should be using to drive, I suppose, progress in those five areas where you did indicate that there hadn't been enough progress?
Could I come in, please?
Would you like to come in, Patricia? Yeah, please do.
Yes, please. Can I just make a general point on conditionality? So fair, we've pushed heavily for conditionality. Mary's made the important point that, as well as having conditions, and if you look at the Fair Work First guidance for the Scottish Government, it talks about investing in workforce development, paying attention to the use of zero-hours contracts, addressing the gender pay gap, opposing fire and rehire policies, instituting family-friendly working. So those are important things which people who spend public money should do, and we shouldn't be using public money to do anything other than that. Mary made a really important point about enforcement. So it's not just about saying these are the conditions to get those grants, but the enforcement's really important. So who decides whether or not that's been delivered in a contract? Our construction inquiry, which was chaired by both Mary and myself, we found evidence that actually public bodies and the public sector, who spend money in a variety of different places, local councils, the NHS, the Scottish Government, they interpret what fair work means quite widely, and the weighting which they give to fair work is often quite low. So there's a really basic job to be done to say, as we said in the construction inquiry, you need to make conditionality, fair work conditionality, matter to whether or not you do or don't get a grant or a contract, and you need to make it matter to the way in which you monitor and enforce that contract. It has to be able to make a difference. So conditionality is an important lever. I think this is an important point. We took advice through the construction inquiry. We took legal advice because you made a point about whether or not it was legal to institute conditionality. We were advised that when we took extensive legal advice, that it was legal, lawful under the World Trade Organization rules to say that you had to pay the real living wage. We were also given advice that it would be lawful to say that in a contract you had to abide by a currently operating collective agreement. And often that's much more significant than the real living wage. So in construction, the real living wage is not really an answer because the challenges are not at that really sort of low pay level. There are other challenges about insecurity. So we're really keen in everything we do to try and explore how we can push the levers that the Scottish Government currently has. There are a whole series of other things about employment legislation and how we might work with the UK government to try and deal with some issues there. But we really tried to push as far as possible how the Scottish Government can use conditionality, it can use its support, it can use its facilitating powers, it can use its advice and guidance that it gives to give employers a whole host of reasons to both engage with Fair Work, but also to know how to do it. Help them with evidence, help them with practice, help them with support, help public agencies in how they interact with businesses to build Fair Work into what they do. Help Skills Development Scotland to do skills in that way, to support skills formation in a way that produces Fair Work. So you're right, there's a set of levers which are far wider than conditionality itself, but conditionality is important.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you. And I'll ask a question of yourself, Mary, likewise, if you want to pass it out. Obviously, we are the Fair Work Committee, but we're also the Economy Committee, and it's well reported the challenges we have at the moment, and everyone will watch with interest to see what the UK budget means and what that flows through and implications for the Scottish Government and the wider economic environment. But with that in mind, can you just put on the record for us today what you see as the key economic barriers to progress Fair Work on your key stakeholders, i.e. employees, employers and the Scottish Government?
Can I ask Patricia?
Patricia, would you like to come in on this?
Yeah, okay. So we know there are big challenges out there. We know there's a cost crisis. We know there's a staff shortages crisis. We know there's an industrial relations crisis. So there's a lot going on, which makes it very, very difficult. The Convention's position has always been that in times of adversity, Fair Work is a good thing for the economy. So one of the arguments that we've made from the outset, and maybe one that's not been taken up as readily by the Scottish Government or as frequently as we would like, is that we don't think Fair Work's a social policy. We don't think it's, as for example, it appears in NSET, we don't think it's simply a poverty reduction strategy, because Fair Work is aimed at every level of the economy. We actually think it's how you build a good economy. We think it's how you build a good, sustainable, robust, flexible, responsive economy. And we think that not because it's a good idea, but because there's good evidence to suggest it. Countries across the world with better Fair Work indicators than ours tend to have innovative and highly performing economies, highly productive economies. So we genuinely believe that's important.
Everything you've said so far, I agree with. But my question was specifically, what assessment have you made in the current climate today of the economic barriers faced by your key stakeholders, i.e. employees, employers and the Scottish Government? I agree with you about Fair Work being enmeshed in economic choices. But I'm asking, given, you know, we've talked about sick pay, we've talked about zero contracts, of course that's under employment law. We haven't yet touched very much on a gig economy generally. But so I'm trying to work out what assessment you've made of the blockers and the barriers today from an economic perspective. So Mary or yourself, Patricia.
So, for the point of view of employees, the biggest issue at the moment is the cost of living crisis. That's very, very clear. We understand that for employers, their own cost constraints makes it very difficult to deal with that cost of living crisis. And in that context, we revert back to how, sorry, two things. One is to focus on how you redistribute the current pot to be as fair as possible. So identify areas where there are real challenges. And we've seen a lot of employers across Scotland do that. We've seen a whole host of employers in Scotland do make one-off payments to their staff. That's often higher at the bottom end of the income distribution than it is at the top end. So we've seen employers try to respond to that and recognise the real difficulties that, workers themselves face. We know the Scottish Government has not got unlimited resources. So when Mary talked about social care earlier, we understand that it's a really low-paid sector. It's now really struggling with staff shortages. That's a big economic barrier to instituting Fair Work if you simply don't have enough people, because the people there end up having to do more. So we know that that's really challenging, but we think that there are ways in which you can redistribute budgets and money to be able to try and address the worst excesses of that. We have real concerns about the extent of being in work and in poverty in Scotland. 60% of adults in Scotland who live in poverty have a working member of their household. We need to be able to try and find a way of redistributing the resources that we have, albeit limited, to make work pay and to make those difficulties more easy to bear across the board.
It's perhaps more of a slightly finance consideration, just as my last point. Within that redistribution then, have you looked and come up with suggested ideas of where you would take money from, given that when you're operating with a fixed budget, to give to something means that you need to take from somewhere else? Have you looked at that from the point of view of Fair Work, and where would you take it from?
We haven't looked specifically at that, so it's not our job to advise Scottish Government on its financial arrangements. One of the things which we did say, and it relates to an earlier question, we did make a public statement some weeks ago in relation to the National Care Service, because we were concerned about the lack of a budget line to support the implementation of our social care recommendations. And we did make a public statement about the need for that to be funded. My understanding is there has been a change in the budget line for the National Care Service, so that some of the money that had been kept to fund the development of the National Care Service is now going to be spent on frontline wages and social care. We think that's a very good thing.
Thank you.
Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, convener. Going back to your December 2020 report, you highlighted a number of sectors that weren't performing well against the Fair Work indicators. We've touched upon the pandemic, but can you say what impact the pandemic has had on these sectors? I know you've done an inquiry into two or three of them. And Patricia, if you can come in on that.
So we know that the pandemic has made the challenges in social care worse. We know that construction, and I'll come back to social care in a second. Construction was an interesting one, because construction was one of the sectors that needed to get back to work pretty quickly in the pandemic. We know across the economy, and not just in those sectors, we know that where people had poor conditions beforehand, most of those either stayed the same or got worse during the pandemic. So if you didn't have access to sick pay, that was much more of a challenge during the pandemic. It tended to be higher paid, more highly qualified workers who were able to go and work from home. We know that one of the members mentioned the gig economy. We know that precarious and non-standard workers were impacted really heavily during the pandemic. We know that quite a lot of them, even though they were eligible for furlough, were made redundant by their employers. We know that the self-employed fell between quite a lot of the support schemes that were available during the pandemic. And so all of those aspects of precarity were made worse in a particularly uncertain situation. How much those, we haven't remeasured, and that's in our work plan for 2023. So how much those, how many of those groups are better or worse off is not something that we can give you detailed or robust evidence on today. That's part of our measurement framework for next year. But it would be our understanding from other evidence and information that that the pandemic hasn't improved the access to things like sick pay. and it hasn't improved security in the economy. There are labour shortages, and that's lifted up wages in some areas, but of course that's been impacted, of course, by the cost of living crisis at the same time. But those labour shortages aren't, for example, pushing up wages in social care particularly, and there are still real challenges of recruitment in social care. It's much easier, probably, to work in a big supermarket than it is to work in social care. It's a demanding job, and you're likely to be paid more in a big supermarket currently because those employers have raised their wages in the context of skill shortages. So we have no particular reason to believe things have got better.
So, I mean, you've touched upon the lack of sick pay, low pay and precarious working. All of that relates to employment law and trade union legislation. So how much of a barrier to achieving Scotland becoming a fair work nation is the fact that these are reserved to Westminster?
It is undoubtedly a barrier. One would expect, if I think about my day job as a professor at a university, we would expect to look in other countries at the whole range of levers which a state has. So it can be a role model employer, it can fund in a particular way, it can legislate and regulate to do things which it can to support fair work. And we would see that in other contexts. So it's undoubtedly a barrier. And therefore, we encourage in certain circumstances, we add in our role as advising the Scottish Government, representations to be made to the UK Government to support particular practices or indeed to not support particular practices. So we've done that in relation to fire and rehire. We have concerns about what will happen with the EU exit sunset legislation clauses. We have real concerns about how changes at a UK level may reduce the protections for workers at the lower end of the labour market in a variety of different ways. And that's something that we have an ongoing discussion with the Scottish Government about, and would try and produce as much evidence and support for retaining protective legislation where possible. But that's a real challenge, a real worry for the Convention and a real worry for our trade union members in particular.
And just my final point, Patricia, you touched upon gender pay gap and living wage. Can you say how Scotland compares with the rest of the UK in terms of the gender pay gap and the number of living wage employers?
Well, we know in both of those criteria, Scotland does well. So we know that Scotland has a very high, I think the Scottish Government put out a report yesterday or the day before, we have a very high number of living wage, of employees who earn the living wage in Scotland. We also know that the gender pay gap for Scotland is lower than for the rest of the UK. And if you think about that, some members have asked about how quickly you can make progress in relation to fair work. If you think about how long we've been working around gender pay equality in Scotland in a variety of different ways, it's taken quite a long time. But actually, we have a lower gender pay gap than the rest of the UK, and that's a good thing. That's a thing to celebrate. But back to your questions about levers. In some of these areas, I think we need to push our levers as far as possible. In some areas, we just don't have levers.
OK, thanks very much. Okay.
Mary Alexander, did you wish to come in on?
Yeah, just to sort of add to the point that you're making about the limitations of UK employment law and the reference Patricia made to the sunset provisions. So I think there are ways that, for example, sectoral bargaining, we can use those levers that we have and that we've recommended in the Social Care Inquiry report. And we can also use procurement in a different way as well. So in the construction inquiry report, we've suggested recommendations to make work fairer. For example, with apprentices' pay, which changed in 2017 when employers used to have to register with federations, and apprentices were paid collectively bargained rates. Since that change in 2017, what we found through the inquiry was that apprentices' pay was very patchy, to say the least, and certainly collectively bargained rates wasn't applied. So we've made recommendations there that would improve pay for apprentices. The other part of there's a number of recommendations, but it's also about applying collectively bargained rates. So there's a number of ways that we could use, for example, procurement to make things better. And, you know, we could use sectoral bargaining, as we've done, as Helen referred to, in the college sector.
Thank you. Colin Beattie, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. We've already been talking a little bit about the significance of the increased costs that are being faced by businesses. I mean, energy costs are a big part of that, but there's also the increased material and labour costs. Now, when this happens, it tends to focus people's minds, and businesses are focused on survival. The workers are focused on their day-to-day issues as well. What's your view on how difficult this will make to progress the Fair Work vision? Sorry, Mary, perhaps I can ask you to come in.
Yeah, I think it will make it undoubtedly challenging. But, you know, we're about Fair Work, we're about people, about companies and all the players, trade unions talking. And I think the more, you know, the more we do that, the better. But, of course, there is, you know, I've never known so many industrial disputes as we've got just now. And, you know, listening to workers on the ground, how difficult it is for them to put food on the table and to manage until payday. You know, they're frequently going, particularly social care workers, are going to financial institutions or, you know, borrowing from families and friends just, you know, just to try and make ends meet. So it is a very, very difficult position. And, you know, there is a lot of unfairness in the system. You know, we see daily reports of companies who have made huge profits, yet they're in dispute because, you know, they're not offering inflation rises or, in some cases, anywhere near that. So, you know, I do think it is very difficult, but, you know, Fair Work is about promoting, you know, how to, you know, how social dialogue and trying to work through things together, as we did in the pandemic. You'll always have employers who aren't really that interested and will continue to pay wages that don't match inflation and are immune to conversations about the impact on workers. But equally, there's a lot of very good employers out there who recognise the problems and will you know, do their best to reward as far as they can, and recognising the position that workers are in. So, and like I said, during the pandemic, the discussions, the industry leadership groups, they, you know, that there was some very positive stuff came out of that. You know, what are the issues? For example, PPE, sick pay. We were able to make progress on those issues by sitting down and having a conversation and trying to work through them.
Clearly, you have taken on board the issue and you understand the issue and how it impacts on the businesses and the workers. How has it changed or informed your course of action, what you do, your approach? Maybe I can ask Patricia to come in on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that at the moment we're trying to think very much about where the real pinch points are. So I would pick up on Mary's point. There are lots of businesses that are doing very well. They may have increased costs of energy and materials, but they're making record profits. So we need to really focus on those businesses where there are genuine challenges in trying to be able to address Fair Work issues. I think we've asked the Scottish Government to focus, and we would like this committee indeed to focus on those people who are being particularly impacted by the cost crisis. So that might be specific sectors, but it might also be different types of households. So, you know, whether that's households with disabled workers in it, whether or not it's households with mainly households with single parents who are overrepresented when it comes to low pay. And I think it's very, very important at a time like this that the existing inequalities in our labour market are not exacerbated. So for the people for whom things were already bad, they don't get worse. I think there are other ways in which we might try to, I'm not going to suggest put a positive spin because it's a very difficult time, but we do know from evidence around the world, and indeed in the UK and in Scotland, we do know that Fair Work's really good for businesses' economic performance. We know that it increases people's discretionary effort. We know that it motivates people. We know that it leads to innovation. So there's very good evidence that actually if we invest in it, we create better, more efficient, more innovative, productive businesses. So there's a very positive side, I think, that we should can make on Fair Work. Can I say one other thing? There are different forces at the moment. So there's a skill shortage. If you were a neoclassical economist, you would say, well, skill shortages are going to drive up wages and make job quality and Fair Work better. So there are other pressures which are encouraging employers, I think, to think creatively about how they can deliver better work so that they can attract and retain workers. There's an important piece of work, it seems to us, to be done around the ageing workforce. We have an ageing workforce in Scotland. We know that you know, we've talked about the great resignation in public debates. We've talked about quiet quitting. We know that economic inactivity is on the rise. And actually, that's a real challenge because we need people to be at work. We have skill shortages. So Fair Work's one way of trying to get people to stay at work, make the workplace look that somewhere that you can stay when you're a bit older. From our own research, that you can stay when you're an older woman and you've got to combine it with a range of care and responsibilities. Fair Work's an opportunity for businesses, even in a crisis, to come together and try and create outcomes that everybody can be comfortable with, notwithstanding how difficult some of them are.
Now, you've touched on the labour market, which is obviously very tight across almost every sector that we've looked at. Some sectors, the skills and labour gaps are, of course, more acute than others. You've touched a little bit on it, but maybe you could expand a little bit on how Fair Work will improve recruitment and retention for employers and help to build a bit more resilience in the labour market. And that's a very hard one. Maybe I can ask Mary to comment on that.
Yeah, I think, as Patricia says, you know, the improving Fair Work in terms of recruitment and retention, we need to look at, you know, what are the problems, and we know there's a number of issues like Brexit that are causing the tight labour market, but I think we need to look at the solutions that are there. So, you know, sorry I keep going back to social care, but I think, you know, there is a real crisis there. Since we started the inquiry in 2017, things were really bad then. They're very bad now. And you know, everybody is saying we need to do something urgently here to intervene. And we know what the issues are there, and it's about tackling those issues providing solutions. So the issues are, you know, about low pay, about stress, about, you know, having to do unpaid overtime, zero-hour contracts, lack of training, supervision and support, in social care. So it's about trying to tackle, you know, all those issues. Same with, you know, our inquiry into construction. You know, we identified, you know, the issues there, and we've got a very big problem there in that it's primarily an ageing workforce who, you know, there is, I can't remember the figures, but it's an awful lot of people due to retire. And when we've got our net zero commitments in construction, there is no way, that we've got, enough workers to fill that gap. And why? Because people aren't going into construction because it's so precarious, it's not attractive for workers. You know, there's a lot of issues around it. But again, I just make the point, it's about trying to understand what the issues are and tackling those. And a lot is obviously to do with Fair Work.
Hopefully, Fair Work is I think recognised by most companies. But in the present crisis, and I'll come back to the issues we've talked about, where especially smaller businesses who don't have a great deal of resources, are focused down simply on survival. How do you get the message across that there's a benefit in Fair Work for them? Because, you know, they're just trying to pay their bills day by day, trying to get through it. How do you get your message across in that feeling of crisis and in the day-to-day chaos almost of trying to survive?
Well, Helen might want to come in, but what I would say is, if you look again at the example of the pandemic, you know, we actually, in my role as a trade union official, spoke to a lot of employers who phoned up and said, what am I going to do? I'm really struggling here and I don't want to, you know, I don't want to have to terminate contracts. Can we please look at, you know, can we sit down and work through this together? And, you know, there was a lot of, you know, there was a lot of collaboration like that, which you never hear about. You only hear the sort of, you know, bad stories around it. But, you know, a lot of employers have got, you know, really good working relationships with their workers, and the workers understand, you know, we're in a really difficult position here, but I'd rather have my job. Let's see what we can do, whether it's, you know, reducing the working week, as happened in a lot of places, you know, during the pandemic, or taking other measures. So there is a willingness there. Helen, do you want
Well, we're running a hospitality inquiry as well at the moment that has just started. And I think hospitality is a really interesting sector in this space because it's very much in the eye of the storm in quite a number of ways in terms of the cost crisis. But it's also in the eye of the storm when it comes to staff shortages. And there's a very odd dimension going on between the sort of cost pressures that are happening in other ways on the business and also those staff shortages. And what we're seeing in hospitality is a lot of employers saying that they actually can't run at full capacity because they don't have enough staff to actually open all the days that they might want to open, particularly in like pubs and restaurants and places like that where you can easily flex down and up. And what that actually means is that they're not maximising their business either. And I think in a slightly odd way, this crisis is creating a lot of interest in Fair Work. It's creating a lot of sort of realisation on the part of some smaller employers who maybe wouldn't have seen that as their core business. They would have seen their core business as doing their business, and these things are sort of, you know, they just come along with it. They're actually now suddenly really interested in how they can improve recruitment, how they can improve in retention. Because I think a lot of employers thought, well, what we'll do is we'll up our wages by 50p and that'll sort it out. And it didn't. I think is the experience in hospitality. We've seen wages rise and actually the staff shortages are staying. So what actually is in there is much more complicated about how you organise your shifts, the security that you offer, the hours that you offer, how perceptions of that sector have developed over the pandemic. And we've seen you know, perceptions of hospitality really decline because of the dismissal of workers during COVID. And that all of those things are having a really are having a really big impact on that sector, but it is also focusing the mind of a whole range of employers about how it is that they make a change and all the different things that they might need to look at in order to make that change. So it's a difficult moment for sure, but it's also a moment where we can see an opportunity to make a gain in that wider understanding of Fair Work.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for your comments so far. I'm going to pick up actually on hospitality in a moment, but I just want to say that I completely agree. I think, Patricia, you said that Fair Work is a way of building a good economy. It's not just about poverty reduction, although that the contribution there is clear. And I think that's one of the conversations that we probably need to have more about in this. And Helen, speaking there just about hospitality, I appreciate that the convention's inquiry into hospitality has just begun and due to report in 2024. But given what we know about the challenges that sector's faced in the last 2.5 years or so, and given that we know that actually some of the things that Colin and others have addressed, we can't really wait until spring 2024 for your recommendations and conclusions. What are the kinds of things that we should be doing now to support and promote fair work in this challenging environment, given what we've said about cost crisis as well? Are there things that we should be looking at? That's a big question, I know.
I think the first thing I said about the inquiry is that we see it as an intervention in and of itself. So actually what we're the end report will hopefully provide recommendations that this sector has bought into and will therefore be interested in delivering as a sector. And I think it's an interesting inquiry. It's different from our other ones in that the lever coming down from the state isn't as visible. So in social care, there was a commissioning arrangement that you could use to sort of drive out fair work in the future. In construction, 50% of construction is driven by public procurement, so there's a really clear public procurement lever that you can use to drive out fair work. In hospitality, it is very much about convincing the employers that there is a different way of doing things and supporting the sector to do better on its own. So one of the features that we're doing in this inquiry is also looking at what levers might exist from the public sector, so whether there's tax, whether there's licensing, whether there's other issues that we could maybe look to incentivise, but primarily this is about supporting the sector to think differently and to do things differently. So we see the inquiry as an intervention, actually, that at each meeting, each time we bring that group of stakeholders together, I think we're helping them understand themselves a little bit better. And understanding their problems. Not that they don't know their problems, they absolutely do, but I think just helping them, giving them some space and a lens of which to look through that might help them see how they can actually link some issues together and maybe make some progress across their sector. And there is a lot of interest and goodwill from the industry leadership groups to actually do better in this space, and there have been efforts made already to do better in this space around the hoteliers charter, around, you know, training that was done through the pandemic, that sort of thing. But what we're seeing is, I think, you know, some other issues that could maybe systematically be addressed. So, for example, a lot of courses will require work experience as part of the course. But one of the things we discussed yesterday was that work experience wasn't necessarily paid, or it wasn't required to be paid. So there's perhaps things there that we can do that change, that sort of shift the culture of how work is seen within the sector. But it is challenging, I think, because the crisis is now. but we are trying our best to support the sector in real time to think about the issues that it has.
No, that's really interesting, and I think culturally that the cultural challenges in that as well. Just in recent discussions with some hospitality employers, one of the things that they said was that, oh, they don't see the need for the unions because their staff trust them. And so just the culture around what actually effective voice means. And I think that brings me to a slightly broader question. Are there other either sectors, or actually maybe do we need to be thinking about cross-sectoral inquiries or cross-sectoral work on this? Because I think there is a lot of, there are multiple interpretations and understandings of exactly what fair work is or could be. And I think one of the challenges that we have, particularly with a third sector, for example, is if, yes, we know we can, well, the Scottish Government can, have conditionality and very, very clear requirements through contracts and funding. But when some of those same workers are also part funded by other funders or have other contractual obligations that don't have those same conditions attached, that puts immense pressure on those organisations who are very often stretched anyway. And I'm wondering what it is that we should be looking at to be able to get beyond or to ensure that we don't have that kind of two-tier system. If you've got a Scottish Government fund or contract, you know you're getting these conditions, and if you're funded by somebody else, well, who knows? You know, if we don't have the levers of employment law and that kind of thing that we've talked about before, how can we avoid that two-tier system?
I think this is one for Tricia, because she's been doing some specific work on this.
Okay.
Yes, I have indeed. And I don't think I have an answer to your question, because it's an incredibly thorny question. So in my day job at the university, we're currently doing some work across the third. We're doing a Fair Work in Third Sector survey and interview programme at the moment. And again, that will be available in the spring. We know that that it's a very heterogeneous sector. We know that it's funded by lots of different organisations and bodies. We know that there are real sticky issues between the legal position, which is and conditionality can only apply to the contract that you're funding, so you can't impose conditionality on other contracts. For a bidder, you can't say, well, you're providing half of your workforce work for a Scottish Government or a local authority funded contract, but you need to pay all of them the real living wage or attract whatever condition. So we know that that's not a lawful thing to do currently, which puts those organisations in a really difficult position, which may mean that they either create a two-tier workforce, which is incredibly bad for motivation and engagement, and actually might expose them to legal liability in terms of equal pay. It might really put them in a position where they have massive risk. On the other hand, that might also mean some of those organisations might pull out of publicly funded contracts if they can't meet the conditionality requirements, so either they won't apply or they won't get them. I don't have an answer to that, because the answer to that involves, I suppose at some level, the best answer I've got is that needs to be a conversation that Scottish Government can have with other funding organisations, whether that be other charitable organisations, whether it be the National Lottery or so forth. It's only by joining up to do that that I think you can square the circle of the legal constraints and the organisational reality of that. But I accept the premise of your question, which is this is an incredibly difficult, thorny issue for the third sector at the moment, and one that they simply don't know how to deal with. And it's not clear how, from a policy level, other than trying to work across funders, it's not clear how you would deal with that. But I think that's where the Scottish Government's role should be.
Thanks, Patricia. That's really helpful. And I think you talk about the potential for equal pay claims and other things. I think we also, you know, we've talked a little bit about gender pay gaps as well. But I think we also know that disabled workers, people of colour, face inequalities in the workplace as well. And I think there's work for us to be doing in that space as well. Finally, and I hope a very quick question. Patricia, I think it was you who mentioned that other countries have much clearer or more robust indicators around fair work. I'd be interested if you could share some of that with us to give us some indication of the kinds of things that we could be pushing the Scottish Government to look for more directly.
Okay, so I think there's two parts to the answer to that. So one is on the kind of data that we collect internationally, so classically labour force data. There are some areas in which the UK and Scotland is not that different, looks different from other countries. So if you look, for example, we talk about fulfilling work being important, meaningful, fulfilling work that uses your skills and talents. About 42% of people in the UK workforce report that they have no control over their job. That is a much higher figure than comparative economies, either in the Scandinavian countries, in Belgium, in the Netherlands, in Germany. So that's an area where that's to do with how jobs are designed and how management practices operate. That's an area that doesn't necessarily have a cost to it. In fact, coming back to the discussion about hospitality, it might have a benefit. It might actually be a benefit if you gave people a bit more control, had a bit more dialogue with them, used the skills and talents that we invest in really heavily in Scotland. We have an incredibly highly educated workforce, but some of that workforce goes into workplaces where those talents and skills are not particularly well utilised. So there are some of those areas where we don't look quite as good as other countries. There's a second part to that, which is more about institutional arrangements. And it is the way in which in other countries there are better processes for collective voice and dialogue, whether that be through social partnership arrangements in some countries, whether it be through the operation of employer guilds who align up with trade union confederations to discuss skills and to discuss pay rates and all of those things. So the institutions that shape fair work in other countries are much firmer than they are in Scotland and in the UK, because we're a liberal market economy where a lot of that decision making is left to employers. It's not really engaged in beyond a minimum by the state. And that makes it, without those sorts of institutional arrangements, it makes it difficult to effect change. I would say, just to finish, we've tried in the convention, and you'll have picked that up from the process of the inquiries, but all of the other work that we do, to kind of create a voluntary version of that. So we don't have institutions that bring employers and policymakers and trade unions and together. We've tried to do that through the inquiries, because actually that's really important. Having that dialogue, at a sectoral level, as well as having that dialogue at a workplace level to get to overcome challenges you're facing. Crucially important. We don't have enough data on that. We don't know where it operates. We don't know where it operates well in Scotland. There will be great arrangements out there, but we saw some of them in the construction inquiry. Some of that data we just don't have. So on some substantive individual indicators, we do less well. And then in our broader arrangements for dialogue and discussion around the workplace, we don't have those embedded institutions.
OK, thank you. That's really helpful.
Fiona Hislop.
So, Professor Finlay, you set out very clearly why Fair Work is good for business in terms of recruitment, retention, but also that issue of productivity, that co-collaboration can lead to innovations. So that's an interesting aspect for this committee, as the Economy Committee, as well as the Fair Work Committee. How do you see the Fair Work Convention working with this committee, and what are your expectations of this committee?
We're very, very happy to work with you on anything that's relevant. It seems to me that message, Fiona, and I know you had direct responsibility as Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work in the past, that message about the economic value of fair work is a really important one to keep discussing. So maybe for politicians there's a role there, and for this committee a role in not just discussing fair work with unions where it gets a good reception, but having that discussion with employers, because we know that employers with certain types of business models actually just expose costs to the rest of society, and often it's the state that picks up that cost through welfare payments or tax credits or any of those things. So I think the role for this committee, the role for politicians, is to do a lot of what we've done in Scotland, which is to have a really important dialogue. Be clear that there is a strong and sustainable policy commitment to fair work. That's not unnoticed in the rest of the UK. We are recognised as leading the UK discussion on fair work. We are consulted with by the Welsh Fair Work agencies. We are consulted with by all the good work charters in England and Wales. We're looked upon as the part of the UK that's taken that further forward. I think my ask of politicians in general and this committee is push the dialogue as far as we can to try and make it a reality. Support the kind of policy levers that we can use so that we can show visible change and progress. Help us to get the data and information that we need to work out where the real pinch points are. I think that would be very much the role of the committee. Keep the dialogue strong around how fair work, as we say in the framework, is good for business, good for individuals and good for Scotland.
Mary Alexander, if I come to you, if fair work, as we say and understand, is good for business and productivity, you mentioned the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which I took from what you said, took more of a social aspect in relation to fair work. Do you think that needs strengthened to push the economic and productivity aspects of fair work? Is that something you'd like to see a bit more improvement on?
Sorry, I'm looking at Helen.
Or Helen, Helen,
because
there, yeah.
You've got more focus on the... insight.
Yeah, I mean, I think the convention is on record and has spoken internally with government a few times on how NSET was dealt with in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And I think the concern here was that it was a bit of a missed opportunity. It didn't necessarily mainstream fair work throughout the entire economic strategy, but rather dealt with it within one chapter. So I think there were some concerns about, you know, the fact that entrepreneurialism, for example, was dealt with sort of separately as a sort of distinct issue that didn't have a fair work dimension. And we felt like this was something that, you know, obviously you could build fair work consistently throughout each element, and and actually it was a really good opportunity to sort of help employers, help other agencies in government understand why fair work, why the wellbeing economy, why these sort of concepts build upon each other and build into that economic strategy. And that was something that we wanted to see done more consistently. So it's not to say that there aren't good fair work commitments in the NSET. There are, you know, the commitment to increase conditionality, the commitment to fair work agreements. Those are very, very welcome. It was more about how that was actually dealt with in a structural way throughout that strategy.
Thank you. And Helen, you'll be familiar that during the pandemic, there was very rapid work bringing together trade unions, employers
and the government on a sectoral basis, basically to try and get the country back to work, you know, after lockdown. And that was intended to continue in the industry leadership groups to make sure that the creative working that took place would help us to improve a whole range of different economic levers that businesses, government and trade unions want. Has that happened to your expectation?
Yes and no. I think there has been an effort to continue with the way of working to a degree. So I think I spoke earlier about the creation of new industry leadership groups. I think I talked about the inclusion of a trade union seat in quite a lot of industry leadership groups, which was very welcome. I think there's still a bit of a concern from the convention side, and Tricia might want to come in on this, about the balance, I think, between the voices. So we often see a lot of employer voices and one union. And while it's a progress to have the one union, it's not necessarily as strong as it might be in a more codified social dialogue model. But it is a step in the right direction all the same. I think the thing that, you know, we had hoped to see a little bit more was sort of a recognition that should be a consistent approach, that it should always have those key stakeholders together. Whereas I think what we've also seen is some more codification of that employer government kind of discussion without the unions present. So there's more structure there than there was previously. And while that may be appropriate and that might be helpful in lots of ways, I think we had hoped to see a more consistent sort of approach and commitment to social dialogue.
Patricia might want to focus on that, but can I do give my final question to Patricia, and if you're the appropriate person to answer this. We've already touched on procurement and in the construction industry in your construction inquiry, and you've touched on what would be legal or not legal. I'm not sure how visible that is to everybody, and that may be an issue about how we make that more visible. But I suppose the issue is, at what point in the process of public procurement for construction do you think the Fair Work can legally be embedded? Is it currently, I think, is at the point that the grant is given, which is after the contract's been awarded? Or is there something that should be done further upstream in the process that would enable better conditionality in that it's actually about the contract as awarded, which means that everybody's in that bidding for it would be in required to comply? I'm not sure in the process whether we can have an improvement. At what point does Fair Work come in?
It's very early in the process, so it's at the point when contracts are it's the point when bids are made that you want bidders to be able to outline their Fair Work commitments in the same way that they currently outline community benefit clauses and some equalities issues. So we would want that to be outlined at the same time. One of the real challenges in things like construction, certainly public infrastructure construction projects, is that they last for quite a long time. So we will have existing contracts which have already been awarded without that attention to Fair Work, but we would really want to see an emphasis, and we've tried to work, for example, with the procurement community to support them, an emphasis in future contracts to make sure that is built in from the beginning, and in finding inventive and creative mechanisms to make sure it's actually delivered. Because there's an issue about whether or not, given the tier system in construction, you know, there's a main tier contractor who subcontracts and subcontracts and subcontracts. Who becomes responsible for the enforcement of that? How do we make clear that it's delivered? But it's early in the process, so it's very clear when people are asked to bid, they know that they're having to bid with Fair Work in mind.
Finally then, is that happening? And is that happening across all the public sector bodies that have procurement contracts?
No, and not in the same way. So there's an awful lot of variation in how Fair Work is interpreted, what weight it's given, whether it's given any weight at all, what difference that makes to the contract, and whether or not it's enforced.
Thank you. Back to Camina.
Thank you. That's helpful. That may be an issue the committee decide to follow up at some future point. That brings us to the end of the evidence session. I'd like to thank all witnesses for coming along this morning and sharing your knowledge and expertise. And I'll now move the meeting into private session.